I'm here at International Armoured Vehicles 2020, and I'm joined with Dr. Bob Sadowski, who is the Chief Roboticist for the US Army.
The Robotic Combat Vehicle is our first foray into developing robots that can go with the combat forces. For years, we've been working on logistic robots. We call those leader followers, where we have following robotic vehicles carrying logistic supplies after a manned platform proves the lane as part of a larger convoy operation. We call those pull bots, essentially. They're pulling logistics. Robotic combat vehicles is our first foray into what I would call point bots. So what we're trying to do is get robots ahead of the formation to provide commanders enhanced situational awareness and actually give them the opportunity to kind of sense where the enemy is and do the sort of dull, dangerous tasks that we always talk about, but in a combat formation sort of perspective. So one of the toughest jobs is reconnaissance. And the recon scout usually finds the enemy position by being fired at. But wouldn't it be great if the robot was being fired at, not a manned platform, for example? So we have different variants. We have a light variant, which is really designed for scouts, a medium variant, which is infantry fighting vehicle killer, an IAV killer with a 30 millimeter on it. We have a heavy variant where we want to explore, does it make sense that the next tank should be manned or unmanned? It's a question. And then in order to kind of further proof the concept, we've been taking small multi-purpose equipment transports, and we'll be taking those to Latvia, four of those, to go with the 173rd. So the ultralight, I call it the Robotic Combat Vehicle Ultralight. So it's on an SMET class platform that weighs about 1 ton, and we have about 1 ton of payloads. So again, all of this is about experimentation with soldiers. The hypothesis is that we're more effective in manned unmanned teaming with robotic combat vehicles than we are without it. And so we'll test that hypothesis with soldiers, and we've already done some great experiments virtually, where if I were to put a tethered UAS on a platform, and it can sit up there in the air, it can look much further than any human can actually, because we don't fly very well. And they can sit there for very many hours. So now you get persistent ISR in a small platform. So these are the types of things that we're really interested in trying to demonstrate and really see, does this really help soldiers fight better in the future?
So what have you got planned for the next year or so in terms of developing these technologies?
Okay, so we have a number of programs that are ongoing. We have work that we're doing with our academic partners to kind of build the algorithms and sort of artificially intelligent inspired algorithms to do behaviors. Because soldiers just don't, you know, maneuver. They maneuver through the battle space. They know where the enemy is. They know their tactical mission. They flow like water across the terrain. And so we need to be able to get robotic systems that can do that. So we have a whole effort within our basic research portfolio with our academic partners to get after that sort of maneuver at the speed of combat, tactically relevant. The other thing we have is a series of experiments where we're going out and sort of buying some because they just don't exist. There's no, like, you know, Toys R Us for big robots. So we're actually going to go ahead and buy some and give them to soldiers. So we call these operational tech demonstrations. Our first one should be coming up in a couple months at Fort Carson. And we're actually using old 113s as surrogates. We're putting some basic weapon systems, the ability to teleoperate these platforms, and they're going to go after, can I actually operate these things when I'm not in them? Because you lose a lot when you're not in the platform, like stability. You might roll it a lot easier, for example. So we're going to learn, can you fight these effectively? And then we're also looking at air-ground integration, small UASs, both tethered and untethered, paired with combat platforms to provide that sort of over the next hill, over the next IV line or invisibility line to give soldiers that enhanced situational awareness at the combat platform level.
So in terms of network-centric warfare, I suppose, how are you looking at joining up the battlefield?
That's a good question. So let's look at how we could organize the battlefield. We could have a forward line of sensors. Think of that as small UASs, a sort of aerial screen. This is all with a sort of organic formation, so we have to give that capability at the lowest level. Then a forward line of robots, and then a forward line of troops. So you could have these robotic systems 1 to 2 clicks out in front of the manned formation to provide a sort of protective bubble and give the commander options. It's all about giving the commander options when to engage, when not to engage, how to kind of sense and feel out where the enemy is. So if you think about coupling that with sort of AI techniques where you can now provide the commander, hey, you know, you have this asset over here who can engage, you give the commanders options to make decision space. General Kaufman would call that Project Quarterback, we're now calling it Project M42, but it's essentially using a sort of decision support template to take the information that these sensors are gathering, collate it, and provide the commander with options on how to engage the enemy as he or she best sees fit.